Ljubljana, Slovenia. French bioartist Marion Laval-Jonté is about to attempt a life-threatening experiment. Her blood is going to be mixed with that of a horse. The aim of her performance piece is to make the blurring between the species and the alleged superiority of man over animals a subject of discussion.
It was a fairly lengthy project. Over 3 years, I tried out all kinds of antibodies separately on my body. On February 22, 2011, I was in a position to have all those antibodies injected in one go.
The biggest danger to which the artist exposed herself was the formation of nitrogen in her body that could have led to the dreaded bends and proved fatal.
The phials contained a cocktail of different types of antibodies, which Marion took in one draft, if you like. This was potentially dangerous because prior to that, a nitrogen conversion process had taken place. Up until then, all antibodies had only been administered separately.
When they took blood afterwards, I realized that, symbolically, it had become centaur's blood. This is a sample. The blood coagulated very quickly, in only 10 minutes. This showed that my body had reacted like it would to serious inflammation. In the week that followed, my perception of things was no longer purely human. It had been modified by impulses, which are normally the emotions of a horse. I suddenly started sleeping badly. I'd sleep for an hour and then lie awake for an hour. Then I'd sleep for another hour and spend another hour awake. In all, I'd get about 4 hours broken sleep a night, which is normally what horses do. There was also this feeling of having great physical strength and marked paranoia.
It's interesting to note that this art is emerging at the present time. There are many explanations. Basically, it follows an era of dematerialization, reflected mainly in the new media art and in digital art. Secondly, today, biology is the leading science per se, so it is perfectly understandable that artists should also take biotechnical processes which, from a technical point of view, are now slowly becoming accessible to them and misuse them, in order to turn them against themselves, so to speak.
It's mainly leading museums that are staging more and more bio-art festivals and attracting more and more visitors.
The aim is for those who view these works of art to come to grips with nature, with technology, or with life, and also with the boundaries between these three concepts. In effect, artists work with the goal of creating insecurity so that the observer is no longer sure whether something is natural, technical, or artificial, whether it is alive or dead, organic or inorganic. That is what the artist plays with.
So far, the traditional art market has taken hardly any notice of this form of art. However, this form of art is not at all market-oriented, nor is it interested in the market. It is not market-viable either, because in most cases, it is not about producing an object, but about displaying transitory processes whose possible end, whose possible death, in principle, represents the actual proof of vitality.
Möglicher Tod im Prinzip den eigentlichen Beweis der Lebendigkeit darstellt.
The exhibitions and performance pieces are always preceded by lengthy and detailed preparation.
There is no doubt that these are often people with a firm belief in what they are doing, who are convinced that in future bio-art will be a far more established form of art than it is today, one that will stimulate a large number of artists to provide society with many interesting and important statements.
Interessante und wichtige Statements für die Gesellschaft zu liefern.
Many of the better-known bio-artists are university professors, like genome artist Paul Vanous. With his DNA manipulation, he questions the distinctness of a DNA fingerprint and warns against the unchangeable uniqueness of our genes.
Technically, what I'm doing is this process called restriction digestion and electrophoresis of DNA. These are ways of processing DNA from an organism so that it will hopefully have a unique fingerprint. When the inventor of the technology spoke about this, he said, if I have called it anything other than DNA fingerprinting, nobody would have cared. Scotland Yard never would have called. You know, call it DNA fingerprinting, and he says, the penny dropped. No one in the general public thinks that a DNA image can look two different ways. They think that one individual has one possible barcode-like pattern somewhere in their cells, that's their DNA identity, and that's it. They don't realize it's constructing a laboratory. So in this sense, then, to then manipulate this thing, which is the gold standard, is truth itself, and to show that it is, in fact, something that can be manipulated by an artist, turns this completely on its head. I can make any image I want. I always show the recipes at the bottom. Basically, these are the enzymes that I used in each lane of the gel to process the DNA. I feel it's important to show exactly how I made the image, that this is not a computer-generated simulation. This is actually happening in wet biology. This is a real DNA fingerprint using this methodology, except this DNA fingerprint kind of undermines the metaphor of the fingerprint itself. I think a lot of times scientists don't realize just how seriously the public takes these images and how little they know about how they're actually created. This is much my point about how useful this metaphor is of fingerprinting to DNA processes, because it makes, it gives the public an easy way of understanding this technology that might not be in any way true, might be completely misleading.
We must be glad to have these artists who go into laboratories as war correspondents, so to speak, and turn these technologies inside out and upside down, and possibly create an initial awareness and maturity, also with regard to a broader public, as to how we need to handle these new developments.
Joe Davis is one of America's most enigmatic artists. For years now, he's worked at MIT, the celebrated Massachusetts Institute of Technology.
So this is a Magnetosporillum magnetotacticum. It's a magnetic bacteria. And Magnetosporillum usually only goes to one magnetic pole, so these guys are mutants going to both poles. I'm interested in using those bacteria for making bacterial radio circuits, bacterial electronics in general. An artist has to open up a window on the world, and you can't open up a window on something you don't know anything about. In that sense, you know, science and art shares the same aspiration. So, this is Alexander Rich Laboratory at MIT. This is the laboratory that I'm affiliated with. It's a pretty typical laboratory of molecular biology. This is sort of the pantry. If you want to make a milkshake, we can probably whip one up.
Beyond this facade of humor and irony, there is profound scientific knowledge, especially of molecular biology. This foundation, this broad scientific base acquired through 20 years of research and work at MIT, is the other side of the coin, so to speak. The humor and irony must not hide the fact that he is undoubtedly one of the most important and most exciting pioneers of bioart.
To remain down to earth and human, for the last 5 years, Joe Davis has worked twice a week washing dishes in his favorite pub.
Joe says that he doesn't believe in any of the stuff that I was talking about. You brought up crop circles earlier, and I said I don't know who makes them. But, you know, I'm perfectly willing to, you know, accept that nature spirits make them.
I'm more of a scientific rationalist.
And he is.
And Brandon's kind of more into the mystical side of reality.
I don't know, it was like 4 years ago, he wanted to change his name. I think he had a number of different options, but my favorite one was Ignatz Ransky-Wansky, and I could be getting it wrong because, you know, he didn't write it down or anything. I just heard what I heard, and I put it in my phone in place of his name, and, you know, like a couple years later, I brought it up and he was like, no, that's not what it was. And I don't even remember. Do you remember exactly what the name was? Or not? I just liked it because it was completely made up and not a real name.
This is like 200,000 Joe Davis's on Facebook. It's
right,
like,
right.
There's even, they used to have a picture hanging in the bar of Joe Davis with a peg leg on the left, spilling his beer. Like,
that's
I have
right.
enough problems.
Right.
Good. I think one of the big things that he brings to our lab at Harvard is that he approaches science and everything that we do from a completely different perspective. So, you know, you have a bunch of dry, you know, somewhat dry scientists, although we tend to be a little bit more on the loose side. He comes at stuff from an angle that nobody else has even thought of, and it helps us to enrich our scientific work.
I think the worst kind of artist is the artist who walks up to me and says, I became an artist because I hate math. Don't talk to me about quadratic equations. That's a terrible waste. It's like an artist has to be as rigorous about what he or she does as everyone else. You know, when we're little kids in school, they present the examples of Vitruvius and Da Vinci, and they say, this is the flower of the human intellect. This is what we can achieve. And, you know, like, it's born into us, this, like, Renaissance. It's born into all of us. We're all artists and scientists. But then, after they teach us that, they spend the next, you know, 30 or 40 years ripping it out of us. You know, we can't do it. The society around us, the culture, doesn't have the capacity to sustain that flower. That's a problem. For as long as I can remember, I've always argued about whether I do what I do is or is not art, right? Somebody's always going to argue about it no matter what I do. Science is the study of nature, but I think art is like always in a wrestling match. It's a contest with the harsh and chaotic forces of nature. Nature is Moby Dick. She's not always very nice.
Originally fascinated by the beauty of nature, former garden artist Jun Takita developed a concept involving genetically modified moss, which glows in the dark. Takita coated an image of his brain with it.
From a historical point of view, gardens have always been places that reflected the scientific or religious knowledge of the day. In the past, it was, of course, impossible to view a living brain. Today, technology makes this possible. Where the evolution of gardens is concerned, I think it is vital to question our nature, who we are, what is human, how is the world built up, and how should we perceive the world. So I regard it as perfectly natural to use my brain in order to contribute something towards the development of gardens.
Bioartists are trying to experience something totally subjectively through their own bodies. That is why they use them as material.
I had my own brain scanned and produced a 3D image of it on the computer. I use a technique called flip-tage to generate a replica of my brain. I want to create an image of contemporary man based on bioluminescence, which is also one of man's creations.
The attempt was made to create a landscape in such a way that it looks like a work of art, but has roots and continues to grow. And now, the whole creation has been brought into the laboratory. So it's a new act. The agricultural sphere has now become a closed scientific area. Part of the designing is now hidden behind laboratory walls because of the need to work in sterile conditions. The public are denied access to this area. That's something I'd regard as new. But the traditional line of working with something that is growing and turning it into a form of art is actually very old.
Personally, I'm not afraid of genetic technology, because a human being cannot be reduced to a vulgar genetic code. We are more than that. Our genetic code is only part of our identity. Admittedly, we inherit our genetic code from our parents. But our existence cannot be restricted to this. From a genetic point of view, we cannot change ourselves. But we do continue to develop. I regard it as perfectly normal for an artist to focus on this theme.
Many bioartists assume that what evolution has produced, the human body as it exists in the 21st century, is basically just the starting point for further evolution driven by human hand. That is why bioart always has an almost theological moment to it, because the thought here is whether the body itself could be overcome. Whether we could live on in a technical or microbial sphere. There's also a certain wish here that we could no longer be bound to our bodies.
Australian bioartist StellArt focuses on extending and overcoming physical boundaries. He is regarded as one of the icons of bioart.
Well, the body is obsolete. The body is inadequate, empty, often absent from its own agency, and usually performs involuntarily. We have to rethink what a body is and how a body operates. So, for example, I might be able to see from the eyes of someone in Melbourne whilst I'm in London and hear from the ears of someone in New York, and possibly my arm will be actuated by someone from Tokyo performing a task remotely.
Bacteria programmed to human needs could form live garments growing out of the body. Former fashion designer Sonja Boimel develops microbiological clothing concepts and experiments with skin bacteria.
I find the combination of art, fashion, design, and science fundamentally exciting. Focusing on bacteria is the result of my entire development and the thesis I formulated. Bacteria have a negative image because we have focused on those that cause disease. However, we have forgotten those bacteria that usually occur in nature and have a positive effect. This work of art is intended to draw attention to these positive bacteria, to show that we should focus on them and see what we can do with them. We know from science that 70% of bacteria are constantly present on us. For 10 years now, microbiologists have known that bacteria communicate with one another with molecules. So what if we could interpret these molecules and create a new kind of material? This would be a second layer which would adapt constantly to the environment, but in a highly individual and personal way. I believe that this could produce a completely new form of interaction, visually and functionally. Here we see the question of how we experience nature being addressed, because bacteria are something we don't experience. Even where hygiene is involved, our cleaning activities are actually directed against something that's invisible. We're only told that it's there. So we clean even before we can see anything. These artists are now trying to make something visible which we otherwise never experience. They are giving us this experience. The idea was to make visible the invisible membrane of an individual on a specific day.
How about a kind of Turin cloth, so to speak? A full body impression with bacteria which one has collected. That was how it all began. There are, you could say, two varieties of skin flora. The resident skin flora that live and nests virtually all the time, and the flora which we pick up through walking around, through swimming, through contact with the air. They inhabit us for a while and then disappear again. These temporary flora are what we have removed from Sonja. This is probably the most difficult way of engaging in art, but that's why it's interesting, and above all because it's novel, because it is a way of combining art and science and establishing a new movement, so to speak. And I'm convinced that at some time or other the whole concept will find acknowledgement in artistic circles.
It's something that's alive, that grows, that you know in advance is uncontrollable, and that gives it a magical quality.
Fathoming one's own body, portraying it in a new way, breaking through barriers. Those are the constant aims of bio-art.
What's meaningful is not to perform for an audience, but rather in that action to explore alternate and unexpected relationships of the body with technology. If an audience might find that interesting, that's fine. If they don't, well then that's not a problem either. That doesn't alter the meaningfulness of what you do, I don't think. Well, I think a lot of these projects and performances have been physically challenging, they've been technically difficult, but it was never an intent that the body should go through a painful experience.
Many artists who work with their own body definitely reveal a marked narcissistic trait. They either want to look into their own body or they want to take something out of their body and portray it, make it accessible to everyone. This might be their own DNA, their own tissue, or some other kind of organ or biological material. What is involved here is the finiteness, if you like, of the artist's own body.
If we're going to engineer artificial wombs and we're going to bring to bear a child completely external to the body, then life will begin without birth. And then if we can replace malfunctioning parts of the body with either stem cell grown or printed organs, or prosthetically augment a deteriorating body, then perhaps a body need not die. So how do we then define existence if it begins without birth, if it doesn't necessarily end with death? And anyway, now, most of us will not experience a biological death. We die when we're disconnected from our life support systems.
There are also protagonists, of course, who refer to our age as the age of biotechnology, because the differences and indeed the possibilities presented by molecular biology processes go far beyond anything man has been able to cultivate in the last 1,000 to 10,000 years. Man still cannot come to terms with the fact that he cannot create nature himself. It is a slight, so to speak, he has felt since the Enlightenment. Before then, it wasn't a problem. Man was grateful for the creation of nature. There was a divine order and every species had its role. Today, of course, mankind wants to extend, remix and produce hybrids and biofacts. Man himself wants to create.
I knew he was this guy who hung out at the local bar called the Plow and Stars. 30 years ago, I would go to that bar and there'd be this guy with a peg leg in there carrying on. That's all I knew about Joe Davis. But then I'd hear this other story at MIT that there's this guy here at MIT. He's a resident artist and he's doing all kinds of strange and wonderful projects. And you should meet him sometime. I never met him. And then finally, the stars aligned and he walked in here about a year and a half ago.
This is the top rundown and it'll have like 5 or 6 holes in it to allow air into the HEPA filter, which is this.
So far that I understand it, we've been making this artificial lung. He's doing some work in Harvard down at one of the laboratories at Harvard, and he's making an artificial lung for mouse embryos. So that it's supposed to keep the embryos oxygenated, keep them alive, and it needs to be glass because they want to be able to use a laser to go in and ablate certain cells to control the experiment. And I think the larger research project is doing chimeras, mouse chimeras. So they're putting rat stem cells into mice and seeing if the mice can regenerate pancreatic function.
I'm interested in, as an artist, how I can create this apparatus besides, you know, outside of the sort of standard apparatus at the laboratory, how I can make something that's sort of like post
cyber, steampunk, Captain Nemo incubators that I can use rat stem cells to grow a mouse lung. And the idea ultimately is that we could use human cells to grow mouse lungs and thereby improve the mouse-human models. But also there's something really crazy and beyond Frankenstein about that.
In 2006, Stelarc had an ear implanted in his arm. This made him famous. In this way, he himself became a work of art and exhibition item.
This ear is not for the artist. The artist already has two good ears to hear with. But it's an ear for people in other places. It's a remote and mobile acoustical organ that might be accessed by others elsewhere. And this is what, for me, is meaningful about the project.
You could also put the catheter underneath here.
The idea was replicating a bodily structure, relocating it, and then hopefully rewiring it for additional capabilities.
The moment he started working with tissue engineering in his extra ear project, he completed a transformation from technology to biology.
There we go.
There was an infection that occurred after the second surgery, probably caused by the inserted microphone, that almost resulted in the loss of an arm for an ear. At the end of the surgery, the inserted microphone was picking up his voice and wirelessly transmitting it. During the second surgery, one surgeon was overheard saying to the others, "Well, you know, maybe it is a work of art, but if it is, we must be the artists." So they half got it, you know.
The pioneer of body art, Hollande, had some of her skin cells removed. These were then mixed with skin cells from an African fetus and kept alive in a bioreactor.
My entire work is based on questioning the status of the body in our society, insofar as it is subjected to social, political, religious, and ideological pressures. It is highly important for an artist to be aware of what is happening in the world of science in order to understand how the body is being taken over by medicine, by science, by biotechnology, and by genetics, etc. Many of my works were inspired by philosopher Michel Serres' The Troubadour of Knowledge. In the preface to it, he talks about the harlequin concept. Harlequin interests me not only because he is a theatrical figure, but also because his coat is made up of different kinds of material and different colors.
Parce que son manteau est fabriqué avec des morceaux de matériaux qui sont des matériaux.
It is this coexistence, this living patchwork, which interests me enormously.
Ce patchwork de vie qui m'intéresse énormément.
Laïcité. Returning from an inspection tour of lunar climbs, Emperor Harlequin appears on stage.
Moi, ce que j'ai voulu faire, c'est effectivement absolument mixer, mélanger.
What I wanted to do was to mix cells of different origin, different sexes and species, both human and animal, and also from different parts of the body, like the eyes or the heart. And in doing so, try to break down the barriers we are accustomed to.
Qui sont d'habitude utilisées ou mises en place.
But the biological processes in the bioreactor didn't go at all according to plan.
At first, I thought it would be possible to produce a totally hybrid skin and even cultivate it. But then I realized that the battle taking place in the bioreactor was something far from utopian. It was always the youngest and most powerful cells that triumphed over the others, which then died off. They subdue the others, which then die off. This was a sobering experience.
Your cells, the WS1, this skin fibroblast, human.
We are questioning ourselves more and more. Who am I? It's the Kantian question. What is the human being? We see ourselves as people in our diversity, but in doing so, we always look for what defines ourselves subjectively. So we can then no longer say, I'm a child of God, created in God's image, the classical variation in our intellectual history. Instead, we say that we are kind of multiplicity of genes, genes also from many other people, which also lie dormant within us. And this is something Orlan and Paul Vanus play with in their art.
I'm not a trained scientist. I'm somebody that has learned the kind of procedures to make this kind of work, but everything I do, I'm approaching as an artist, and even the way I learn the procedures is in the way a hacker learns to program computers. You're making things with it that are designed to kind of interrogate it itself. They're self-reflexive. They're, I'm making DNA fingerprints as images to talk about, how we understand the DNA image, right?
Artists like Paul Vanus point out that old ideologies we thought were long dead are re-entering through the back door via new technologies. Eugenics, physiognomy, the attribution of character traits on the basis of physical features, nose shapes, everything that has been done right through to Nazi ideology. Naturally, Paul Vanus asks how far from the potential for surveying the body, from physiognomy, from eugenics, a molecular racism might emerge in which it is no longer the body, but body fragments that can be studied and eradicated.
Heute möglicherweise ein molekularer Rassismus werden kann, in dem nicht mehr der Körper, sondern die Körperfragmente.
And this, that, or the other band from our social biological pool.
Und diesen aus unserem sozialen biologischen Pool zu verbannen.
Human genetics begins with eugenics over 100 years ago to this movement committed to creating, better humans. I was always suspicious of this notion, and I was certainly suspicious of the idea that we were going to know everything about ourselves through a DNA genetic imprint. DNA moved at different speeds in DNA fingerprinting gels. I realized that, if I were just to let this DNA gel run, one would run off the gel first. I could basically run a race. My family just coincidentally comes out of Jamaica, and we are this very hybrid-looking family in which, I kind of look mostly white. My sister probably looks mostly black, depending on who's viewing. So in that experiment, what I did was I invited my family over. They live all over the country. Said, why don't you guys come over, have a to have dinner. And I broke it to them also at some point that, in fact, I was also looking to get their blood, amplifying just our skin color genes. And then those skin color genes are what race against one another. My father won the most races, but my mother's average velocity was the highest. So those are the two wingers, I guess. My sister and I, for some reason, did not fare so well. You know, to be honest, I did not want to win this race. I wind up thinking the more that we see ourselves as our kind of genetic profiles, we're going to lead to new ways, new types of discrimination. Probably not even the type of discrimination which is very sort of well thought or thought through.
So this is Irina Vladimirovna. She's a friend of mine who's an artist and collaborator. We've worked together on several projects and DNA panties, which are pretty cool. That's about a special set of genes that we all have, all human beings have, called major histocompatibility complex. And these genes control the array of receptors on the surface of every cell that trigger resistance to disease. And it's been shown in the last few years that mice and human beings, that the female of these species can detect whether or not their sexual partners have like or unlike MHC complex. If they're unlike, well, then everything's fine. But if they're like, if they're especially in estrus, women, females of those species are much more likely to have infidelity in their sexual relationships. So I used a kit and sequenced my own DNA, and then we printed them on women's panties. So these are part of our lab-inspired apparel. We're thinking about making lab coats with hoodies and lab coats with capes. And these panties are now all over the world. What do you think about that name, lab-inspired apparel, labia? The genome holds many secrets about Homo sapiens, who they are, how they work. But in the genome, in this incredible archive, there's no genes for things like to explain why we would be interested in the genome in the first place, why we would want to understand the structure of DNA. There's no genes for things like hope, eroticism, love. These are the things I want to write back under the world, to give back to this like opera running underneath everything. That's the that's what my it's like returning to life. That's what my work is really, sort of the one of the driving forces of my work.
Whereas an artist in classical times perhaps dreamt of creating a work of art that depicted a hybrid or a chimera involving a dragon and a human being, or a horse and a human being, bioartists today are reflecting quite seriously with scientists as to whether such transformations, rewriting of the genetic code, should actually be embarked on. Here, basically, myths are becoming reality. We have started to understand the research that has taken place in biotechnology on the boundaries between the species. We then thought about how we participate in this research. The question is, to what extent can we really eliminate foreign bodies? The body might be able to excrete a certain number of them. At the same time, however, A trace of foreign elements always remains in the body. I will always have proteins modified by horses in me.
To us, science is not what it is for many people, something that makes our lives easier. On the contrary, we realize that technology is making our lives more complicated. Because in the final analysis, our possibilities and the questions with which we are confronted are becoming more and more terrifying.
Indeed, focusing on bioart involves an additional risk. Not only is it highly expensive, it can't be sold. And you've got hardly anything to show, at best, the impression of an exhibition. Despite this, I really gain the impression that I have found my entire freedom and all my artistic values in this art concept.
I think there's such a thing as self-fulfilling prophecy. Sometimes we can make a fallacious prediction, and then out of our control, the prediction comes true. There are forces at work that make such prophecies self-fulfilling. So I think it's really important to have good dreams, to have another alternative explanation. That's what my work says about humanity.